This is the first time you're seeing pictures of Christians from the villages openly praising God.
Exclusive access into China's underground churches.
I was stabbed over 50 times and almost lost my life.
Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. For years after the revolution in China, they tried to restrict religion, but that hasn't prevented China from becoming one of the fastest growing Christian nations. CBN News reporter George Thomas introduces us to a couple of Chinese evangelists who are witnessing many miracles firsthand.
Duan Huailei says these images captured on his home video camera are proof that God is moving in China.
This is the first time you're seeing pictures of Christians from the villages openly praising God.
Duan gave CBN News exclusive access to hours of video and pictures taken in dozens of locations across China. They show one thing in common: men and women of all ages being touched by the power of God.
Everywhere I go, I meet people who are hungry for God, and He's showing up.
Duan and his wife are full-time evangelists. Since 2003, they've crisscrossed the Chinese heartland, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ.
God called us to focus on the rural areas where life is often very difficult.
Difficult, yet simple in many ways. Duan showed CBN News pictures of how people are baptized in rural areas after they've accepted Christ into their lives.
Sometimes I baptize them in a river. Sometimes they are baptized in the back of a pickup truck. A couple of times I've conducted baptisms in the shower. Very often we just have to improvise.
It was here in the Chinese countryside that Christianity first began decades ago. Most of the rural Christians now are women, meeting in either government-sanctioned churches or in so-called house churches.
The young and older men have moved to the big cities to look for jobs. And so most of those who attend these services are older women.
And mind you, sharing the gospel in China is still forbidden.
I was arrested here a number of times.
Such Christian gatherings are illegal since they aren't approved by the government.
The government doesn't allow people who live in one city to travel to another city. We are mindful of the regulations.
Despite the government restrictions, China watchers say what's happening spiritually in the country is nothing short of remarkable.
There are still masses of converts every day in the countryside. It's very encouraging.
This man, who we will call Peter, has worked with China's underground churches for decades. CBN News agreed to conceal his identity to protect him.
But still, so many peasants in so many places are coming to Christ in large numbers in churches, and in many of those cases are maturing and getting beyond simple evangelism and reaching out to rural minority groups and unreached people groups.
Today is Communist China's new and global manifesto, militant and menacing.
It's a far cry from the dark days of the Cultural Revolution. Fang Gongyang heads the Center of Religion and Chinese Society at Purdue University.
At that time, all churches, temples, and mosques were closed, and no public religious service was allowed.
Chinese government data and international surveys now report millions of Chinese people flocking to religions like Christianity, Buddhism, Taoism, and Islam. But it is Christianity that's experiencing the most dramatic growth. CBN News obtained this map showing the stunning picture of Christianity's explosion across China's cities, counties, and villages.
If the current trend of growth keeps the current pace, I think it's likely in the next 30 or 40 years, China's the number of Christians in China could reach really a high number, perhaps similar to the U.S. or Brazil.
Duan says the preaching of the Word of God in the countryside is usually followed by miracles and healings.
People who could never walk before begin walking. The blind see. I've even witnessed a man being raised from the dead. We see amazing healings and miracles each time we travel.
Duan is a walking miracle himself. In the late 90s, he and his wife lived in Budapest, Hungary, running a successful clothing company.
We were making lots of money and living the high life, but I didn't know the Lord. I soon realized I needed something more than material success. I eventually gave my heart to the Lord.
6 months after giving his life over to Jesus Christ, Pastor Duan was viciously attacked by members of a Chinese mafia team based in Budapest.
He shows us the knife scars on his back, arms, and stomach that he says serve as reminders of God's protection and faithfulness.
I was stabbed over 50 times and almost lost my life, but I know God spared me for a reason.
And this is it, the opportunity to reach the remote parts of this great land with a message of hope and salvation found in Jesus Christ.
I preach in the government-sanctioned churches and house churches, and in both places, God is moving in powerful ways. My prayer is that one day, everyone in our nation will hear about Jesus Christ.
George Thomas, CBN News, Beijing.
What a wonderful report. You know, when you go to see the these small churches in China, and you see the faithfulness of the people, and then they break out in joy. True revival. And yes, I'm one of the ones that believe it will happen, and it'll happen probably in our generation. China will have the largest Christian population on the planet, and that will be a good thing. Well, up next, a man who put his life and his freedom on the line to reach the people of China.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer, but I decided,
if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else.
And to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things.
Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people and they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Call or go to cancercenter.com today to learn more about our unique approach to state-of-the-art cancer care. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Vertical skateboarding was the sport, and all of a sudden I'm about to be one of the best skateboarders in the world, and none of the drugs really hooked into me like crystal methamphetamine did. I was saying, tomorrow I'll quit, tomorrow I'll quit, tomorrow, tomorrow, tomorrow.
This is Christian Hosoi, and this is his story. Tune in to 700 Club Interactive on ABC Family tomorrow.
Well, in China, smuggling Bibles is a crime, and it can carry a prison sentence. But that hasn't stopped one man from doing just that for 25 years, and we can't give you his name, so we're just going to nickname him Maverick, and thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Gordon.
Why do you have to wear a disguise?
I have just to protect the identity of my friends, my family, myself, and so... I'm Maverick.
When did you first go to China?
1986. My wife had a dream, and in the dream, the Lord appeared to her and said, it's harvest time in Hong Kong. So we were seeking the Lord as to what we should be doing with our life and where to serve the Lord. and he said Hong Kong, and we were on a one-way ticket, and we established our home there, bought a home there.
So based just on a dream?
Just on a dream.
You bought a one-way ticket.
We did. Mm. We did.
No return.
No return.
And plowed everything you had into Hong Kong.
And had no idea what to expect. We didn't even know what a Chinese New Year was. We didn't know how to handle chopsticks, but we just fell in love with the people. The people are so warm, hospitable. They love Americans. They, you know, years ago they used to call us Guaylos, foreign devils, but now they just welcome us, they honor us, and it's just a joy to just share the good news with Chinese people.
Back in the 80s, tell me the risk of smuggling Bibles into China.
Well, they would take them away from you, but they wouldn't arrest you. Mm-hmm. However, if you were caught actually preaching the gospel, which we've done many times in all the English corners all over China, they would actually deport you, maybe sometimes for 5 years, as many people have experienced. We call that honorable discharge if you get caught doing that.
Why is it illegal to preach the gospel on a street corner?
You know, it's crazy. They'll tell you we have churches, the people can go to the church. They'll say we have Bibles, you know, people can buy the Bible. But the problem is that there's not enough of them. There's not enough churches, not enough Bibles. And so we go there to share the good news with people, because otherwise they're not going to hear. And our special niche is the business professionals, the college students, because as you saw in that piece you just showed, those are the rural people. We need more courageous Americans to go over there, go into the universities, openly share Jesus Christ with those people, and give them an opportunity to hear, because most of these people never even prayed a single prayer in their life. They have no knowledge of God unless we go.
What's the best avenue for somebody watching the show right now? What's the best avenue for them to get into a university and to begin to share the gospel?
You know, if you type in on Google how to go to China, teach English in China, you'll get millions of hits, because the Chinese are still crying for people like you and I to go over there and teach English over there. Mm-hmm. Another way to do it is to just go down to your local university right here in America and find the Chinese and the other internationals and share the Lord with them, because they're coming to our shores in droves, and most Christians don't even know about that. And Gordon, I wrote this book, In the Dragon's Lair, because I want Americans to say, don't just say God bless America, say Americans, how can we bless God? And the way we do that is we share the greatest thing we've got, the treasure of the gospel.
I love the subtitle to your book, A Cure for the Bored. You know, why do you think a lot of Christians in America have, and I think it's true, a lot of them are bored.
Right. You know,
and they're bored with going to church. They're bored with the church service.
Well,
I hear that frequently.
Yeah.
Frankly. And why is it a cure?
We Americans have a big theological problem. First of all, we think we should only share the gospel with our friends and our relatives. And in my book, I tell people that Jesus never preached to his friends and relatives, nor did the apostles. They were always strangers.
His relatives actually rejected him.
We have a mission. Yeah, they did.
They came to him and said, you're being a little crazy here. And so, why don't you come home with us?
Well, we're bored because we're not out there sharing the good news with people. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, this is the secret ingredient of the Christian life. Unless we're sharing Jesus with people, there is a whole dimension of the life that we are missing as a Christian. And it's just central to the kingdom of God. We should be reaching out.
What happened to you when you started reaching out?
Changed.
What were you before? I mean, you know, your wife has a dream, and it's kind of unusual. You sell everything and move, and no return ticket. But what was your walk with the Lord like before that?
Well, I wasn't exactly a quiet Christian. I did share the gospel with people. The real transformation came when we started in Hong Kong just sharing with one or two people, and the Chinese would just crowd around us, and we had to speak louder to the people. And next thing, I says, my wife, you go over there and you teach the people a little bit, and I'll go over here. And next thing, the crowds got bigger. And next thing you know, we're on the park bench and we're shouting, Jesus Christ is Lord of heaven and earth. He made you. He has a plan for your life. He wants to come into your life. Give your life to God. This is a glory to God. And they listened and they responded. And they came alive and they said, this is what we want to do. And they're getting baptized and they're joining the church. And life just got so exciting because we started going and started speaking. And God just kind of kept pushing us forward more and more. Next thing you know, we're street preachers. Who couldn't believe it?
Did you ever get heckled?
Yes. Yes, we did.
It's not all,
it wasn't all glory. And you know what's kind of funny is that sometimes we love the hecklers, because when business got slow and we're starting to preach the gospel in the streets, the hecklers would come, they start yelling at us, and we'd bless them in Jesus' name, and before you know, we got a big conversation going on, and then more people would come to hear the hecklers, and so we love the hecklers and we wanted more of them.
So you actually encouraged them.
We love the hecklers. We bless the hecklers, and next thing you know, the hecklers are getting baptized too.
You saw miracles too. Tell us about those.
Well, probably the biggest miracles we saw was just people just receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit and just experience Pentecost all over again. Now, I was not a great Pentecostal preacher, but we just told people, raise your hands to the Lord. God's going to bless you today. You know, the Chinese love to hear that. You tell anybody that no matter how lost they are, God's got a plan for your life. He's going to bless you today. I want you to open your heart to the Lord. We pray for them to receive salvation. Then we ask them to pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit at the same time. They begin speaking in tongues, and I've never seen anything like it. It's just a total miracle, and it's just wonderful to behold.
What do you see as the future for China?
Do you know, China is going to be the largest Christian nation on the planet someday. Not only a superpower, but a super Christian power. And one of the appeals I make in my book is that Christians need to just recognize that we need to get hold of the dragon now and preach the gospel to the Chinese, so that when they do become a superpower, they will become a Christian superpower. And the influence of the gospel is affecting these young people now. And those are the kinds of people we want to see in power.
Amen. The book.
Sure do.
It's called In the Dragon's Lair. It's available nationwide. And Maverick, thanks for your life.
Hey, well, thank you very much, Gordon,
thanks for
having me.
All right. Well, still ahead, we'll stay in China to hear from a boy who needed life-saving surgery his parents couldn't afford.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Mr. Zha was overjoyed when his wife gave birth to twin boys, but that joy turned to fear when they learned that one of the boys had a serious medical problem.
In China, it's a tradition for families to throw a party after a baby's first month of life. And Mr. and Mrs. Zha had double the reason to celebrate, because the couple had twin boys. But 6 months later, there was a problem.
Jinwen wasn't growing. I was afraid that maybe there was some kind of problem with my baby's heart.
A doctor confirmed it. Jingwen had a hole in his heart and needed immediate surgery to survive. Mr. Zha found a job as a delivery man. He worked 10 hours a day and saved everything he could. Even so, with an income of only $110 a month, it would be years before he had enough to afford heart surgery for Jingwen.
I was under so much pressure that I couldn't sleep at night. I started worrying that we might actually lose Jingwen after all.
There seemed to be no solution until they heard that CBN was coming to town to help children like their son. CBN paid the balance of what the family still needed to make Jing Wen's surgery possible.
When I first heard about CBN, it gave me hope. I told myself that we had met the best people in the world, and I took my baby to the hospital immediately.
A doctor repaired the hole in Jing Wen's heart and repositioned his artery. After this successful surgery, the baby finally started to grow. The good news called for another party, and this time it was in honor of Jing Wen's second chance on life. CBN hosted the celebration, complete with cake and a year's supply of vitamins to help with Jing Wen's development.
Thanks to your help, Jing Wen has caught up with his brother. I'm so happy to see how fast he's growing.
Thank you, CBN, for everything. You made it possible for Jing Wen to see another day.
And thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of that. We love the people of China. We want to show them that God loves them too. And we're doing it in very tangible ways. And we're doing it in your name. CBN China, we've adopted a Chinese name, Shi Bo En, which means see broad love. And we want the Chinese to know God loves them. We love them. And we want to show them that broad love and do it in very tangible ways. We're doing it all legally. It's all with registration with the Chinese government. But it's wonderful what can happen when people get together and say, we can go there, we can help people, we can be a blessing to them and show them the love of Jesus Christ. If you want to join in it, all you have to do is join the 700 Club. A portion of every gift goes into the work of CBN International to help people and to help them in very tangible ways. We're also preaching the gospel in China. We're doing it in Cantonese out of our office in Hong Kong. We haven't gotten broadcast yet on the air in Mandarin, but Lord willing, we keep knocking on that door. God will open it eventually. If you want to be a part of it, call us, 888-777-1999, or just log on to CBN.com. If you want to designate your gift to CBN International, you can do it on the website. There's a place on the giving page where if you want to designate it to overseas activities, either humanitarian, evangelism, disaster relief, you can do that on CBN.com. Well, Brian Britton has met with pastors halfway around the world from the comforts of his own home. But when he spoke with church leaders from Pakistan, he no longer wanted to be thousands of miles away.
So when we stepped off the plane in Pakistan, we immediately kind of knew this is not, places like even we've been to before. It didn't feel like Africa. It didn't feel like Israel. It didn't feel like Europe, South America. This is a little bit different. We had a personal security team with us, the whole time that we were there, and they were armed. So that's kind of different. You're not used to preaching with people with AK-47s and shotguns around you. Armed people from the church would be there, to protect us too. And you really had this sense like these people love us. They would give their lives for us too. I began a correspondence online with some leaders in Lahore, Pakistan, through our church website. And we began just spending time together, conversing via the internet, email, Skyping, things like that, just encouraging each other, praying for each other's churches, and that's how it all began. It was just a kind of like an online relationship between some Christian brothers just praying for each other. Pastor John over there in Lahore, him and his wife, Pastor Rachel, they both lead a church over there together, and they're evangelists. They asked me to begin to speak to their leaders, so we started utilizing Skype, and I would come on to Skype, we would pray for each other. I encourage you that I would speak to several leaders at one time. They're like, we really want you to come over here. Please pray about bringing a team and coming over. And so we did. We began to pray, and we set a date for the trip, and we went over in the first week of May. The first big crusade we did, we saw 1,000 people saved right off the bat. So we knew something special was happening. But we also saw these healings, and we saw 1,000 people healed. And we saw Muslims being healed just as much as we saw believers being healed. I mean, and some gave their lives to Jesus, and some didn't. So God loves his people, and we got to see that on display. We just released healing or like, the Lord's your healer. Just receive healing right now in the presence of God. And then we would make a testimony time where we'd have the people come up and tell other people. And it would be like, you know this person, you know they couldn't see and now they can see. Or you know this person, they couldn't walk and now they can walk. It'll mess with some people's theology a little bit when people think, oh, you have to be a believer to be healed, or you have to, you know, have this much faith to be healed. You know, like, God is the healer. And if you believe it, if you believe that, you know, it happens. Even while I was there, I was posting pictures of these people being healed on my Facebook page, you know, so our people back home, you know, could see what God was doing. We were visiting a town to do a crusade that night, and they said, we want to show you the tourist attraction in our town, which happened to be the birthplace of the main Sikh prophet. So we went in. I thought we were just going to tour it, take some pictures, it's beautiful, you know, prayer walk it, and that would be about it. The pastor I was with said, hey, let's record a gospel message right here. So we set up the video camera, the flip cam, and recorded a gospel message inside the Sikh temple, and it was translated, and people heard it. In the video, we said, you might be a Sikh, you might be a Muslim, and if you are, we want to tell you about Jesus and the living God. And so we were able to do that right inside that Sikh temple. So that was pretty amazing. We thought they were going to stop us at a particular time. We kept looking around. You can actually see why I'm doing it. I'm kind of like looking, waiting for them to come, like rush us, but they didn't. And matter of fact, they invited us to have dinner with them after it was over. We feel that God's just given us this great window there. So we're going back in September. We want to see 50,000 one to the Lord. And we're thankful for the opportunity to share. But we can't wait to get back there. In the villages in Pakistan, there's not a lot of the technology was not great, you know, the capabilities that they have. But in the cities, there is. The younger generation that's really plugged into the things that are happening in around the world are hungry for technological gadgets, just like people are here. God's really using technology, and we've seen him use it. One of the things that I would really love to see is for the body of Christ to really grasp, you know, how the world communicates today. Just do a better job with that. Skype and Facebook and the internet is a tool that God's given us to spread the gospel at a rate that has never been possible before.
What an incredible story from Brian. You know, here he is, a pastor in Virginia, and literally from his study, he's on Skype and interacting with Christians in Pakistan, and gets an invitation, and what a life-changing trip that is, and then ongoing ministry back to the same people who invited him. What incredible tools we have. Start using them. You know, realize you can be an evangelist. God has called you to do this. The Great Commission is not the Great Suggestion, and it's for all Christians to go and share the gospel to every language, every tribe, every tongue. And when we engage that and get involved in that, it will revolutionize your life. Well, we've got time for some questions. Let's go over to Marguerite.
It's Gordon, this is from Carter. If you decide to become a missionary or work with missions, do you think that you should be prepared to give your life, or should you trust and claim that God will always protect you?
When you become a Christian, you need to be prepared to give your life, because it's no longer you that live, but Christ that lives in you. And you need to be prepared to give your life. It's no longer your life. You've been bought and paid for. And that goes through stages. And I know in the mission field, it's sometimes easier to be a Christian than it is in the comfort and security of America. But that's part of being a Christian, being ready to give your life. Let's go to Joseph for one more question.
We have Jordan. She says, just how dangerous is it to share your faith in a country like China? Hasn't the government become less strict when it comes to religion? And how secretive does the underground church have to be?
Real quickly, I got asked more questions at the Detroit airport coming back from China than I did going to Beijing. So it's all relative. It's all where you are. But in most of the major cities in China, actually, you're really safe.
Well, that's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Psalms. I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. God bless you. We'll see you again.